Hi, I'm Ben-Yaakov. This presentation is entitled MOSFETs Vgs Flatness During Transitions. This is an intuitive explanation. There is a relevant video deciphering the gate charge curve of power MOSFET. Here's the link. I'm going also to print the link at the page of this video, this YouTube video you are now watching. And also please note that there is an explanation of a common mistake at the end, so just don't miss it. Here is the problem that we are addressing. If we look at VGS during turn on of a transistor, this is the lower MOSFET, current is coming in, actually passing through the upper transistor, and now we turn on this lower transistor, the gate, and typically what we are going to see that the voltage of the gate, that is at this point, here is a sharp transition, but at this point we're going to see a voltage is going up. This is charging the capacitor, which is okay, but then it's going to be flat in many cases, and then it'll go up again in a sort of an exponential curve. At the same time, we see that during the flat portion, there is a drop in VDS. This VDS is dropping during this flat range. And of course, as we reach this point, current is shooting up to about the inductor current. This is a peak due to the reverse recovery of the diode. It could be much larger. In this particular case, there is a Schottky diode, so the peak is rather. This same phenomena is seen as we look at the curve of VGS as a function of the total gate charge. And we see here this flat portion because we have a constant current, and this is actually the integral of the current. And this is the Q, there's no time here, just the total charge accumulated until this process ends. And then charge again is going up when charging the sort of parasitic capacitances. Before going into the explanation, let's just see the phenomena itself. In this case, we are replacing the inductor by a current source because during this transition, the current is just about constant. And we also neglecting the reverse recovery of the diode. So we start off with the current going through the diode, and here now we have a transition at the input to the gate. This is here the input, and of course we'll be moving on this curve to this point, say. This is now the curve that's showing the dependence of the drain current on VGS. We see here just about the threshold here, and then the current will start going up. This is different temperature, and we see it here. Here we're going up with the gate voltage. Drain current is starting to rise. Still, we don't see any change in VDS. Now, next step, we have reached the inductor current, and at this point, the current through the diode is actually dropping to zero because now the transistor is pulling all the inductor current, so the current here goes to zero, and we are here at the edge of the process starting of this flat portion. And here we reach the VGS, which corresponds to the inductor current. And then there is a little bit more of a rise here because there are some capacitor, we'll talk about it in a minute, and then we see a flat portion here. This becomes constant, the voltage here. We are staying at this point, sort of frozen here, while the voltage of the drain is dropping until it reaches just about zero, and then the process actually ends and we go back to charging the parasitic capacitor. So this is the phenomena that we see. So in order to explain what is going on in this flat portion, let me simplify the circuit and represent it by a basic model. So here is the circuit, and I'm representing it by a dependent current source. This is a standard MOSFET representation of the source, GM times VG minus VT, of course VG larger than VT. And then I'm just sort of simplifying it one step farther in order to make this a simple expression. I'm putting the GT here, the threshold voltage here, so this is the actual gate, you might say, that is affecting the current source. And here we have the input resistor, and this is the drive. So this is a very simple model of the MOSFET. During the portion of the time that we are talking about, it is during this flat portion, in which it's already in the conduction region. Now we introduce the capacitances. There is an input capacitance gate to source, gate to drain, and of course the output capacitor. These are very important in understanding what's going on. So let's now have a look at what is the input impedance that we see when we look into the gate during this portion of the time that we have the flat VGS. In order to find out what is the impedance, what I'm doing is that I'm doing a perturbation, adding some voltage to the input. As a result of this added voltage, then of course we'll have an added current here, and this added current will cause a change in the current here and a change in the current here. The sum of these is equal to this. This is constant. I'm just talking about a perturbation, okay? So I've done a perturbation in the gate. I'm seeing a perturbation in the current, and this reflects into these two currents, which, by the way, is being divided by the value of the capacitor. This is like a current divider, a capacitive current divider. This is the source, you might say, and these are the two currents. So what is this delta I? This delta I is, of course, Gm times delta V gate, that is this perturbation here at the input. Now, what is now this current? Why am I interested in the current? Because the definition of the input impedance, of course, is the voltage divided by the current. This is the current. It's the current through the capacitor. So the current through this capacitor is this current, and then taking into account this current divider, as I've said, the fact that this current is being divided between these two. So this is the divider. So the input impedance here is the voltage divided by the current, and this is the current of this gate to drain capacitance. This is this ratio here. And I'm plugging in this value here, and the delta I CGD that I found from here, this is this value, and I'm getting that the input impedance is equal to this ratio of capacitances over Gm. So this is the input impedance to this circuit. So let's have a look at some real numbers for some specific transistor. Here is the current as a function of VGS. Let's assume we are walking around this place, 20 amp. So the slope here is 20 divided by 0.8, it's 25. Now the capacitances here, let's assume we are working around 40 volt, so we have 500 and about 200. So this ratio becomes about 3.5. So now plugging in the numbers into the expression for the input impedance, here it is, we get that the input impedance is 0.14 ohms. I'm now putting back the gate to source capacitance. And here's then the situation during this flat region. We have RG, we have the threshold voltage, and then we have a 0.14 and this CGD. Now the time constant here is very short. So basically we have a voltage divider. So all through this process, we see here an input impedance which is resistive, and therefore the voltage here is constant. No need for it to change, maintaining it constant until the voltage VDS is dropping to zero. So during this time, current is flowing this way, the voltage is slowly going down until it reaches zero. And then, of course, we are still charging the input capacitance, but then the voltage here is already zero. Well, there is an RDS on, it's practically zero voltage. As we can see, during this flat region, we have the input voltage, RG, a offset, and then a resistor, small resistor, and therefore the voltage of the gain, which is slightly above the threshold, is maintained constant until the voltage is going down and down. It's going down because these capacitors are being charged or discharged, whatever you look at it. And finally, this voltage goes down to zero. And then we are, of course, charging this capacitor like passive capacitor, although they are non-linear. Now, the explanation which I'm showing here really doesn't take into account many second order or even first order, but additional effects like the fact that GM is non-linear, diode reverse recovery, non-linearity of the capacitor, and also that the value of RG will affect actually the way things behave. For example, I'm running here simulation with two RGs, two resistors, and you can see that when the resistor is large, we see this classical shape. Now, when the resistor is small, in this particular case, we see that we have a ramping up of the current because the gate current is very high due to the smaller resistor, so there is a ramping up, and then there is a drop. So there's sort of an overshoot, you might say, and this causes this VGS to actually change a bit. It's not maintained constant, as in this case, which is along the explanation I've given before. There is a charging of the capacitor, and then we reach the point in which the current is already the current of the inductor. So the values of the current are actually frozen and the VDS is going down, and then everything sort of tapers off. So this is a very simple explanation of this flat portion of the VGS during the turn on. Now there is another point that has to be perhaps emphasized. Actually, there is a common mistake that this capacitor is usually called Miller capacitor, because it is connected between the gate and the drain. Now, this name comes from the Miller effect, and for example, if you have an operational amplifier or any amplifier in which you connect a capacitor or in fact any impedance between the input, the negative input, to the output, and this is now a voltage gain. It's a voltage gain amplifier. Then it can be shown, of course, that the input capacitance that you can see is larger than the original one by this factor 1 plus AV. AV again is the voltage gain. Well, this is not the case here. Here we have a current source, a GM. And once you change the voltage here, it invokes current. And say in this case, this current will be passing here. So what you see here is actually this current, independent on this value of the capacitor. So in this case, the input impedance is just 1 over GM. That's it, when you look into here, independent of the value of this capacitor. Of course, if you have another capacitor here, as we had it before, you have to take into account current divider, but still, this is a current being pulled in independent on the value of the capacitor. It's depending on the ratios here, but not on the value of the capacitor. So this is a significant difference between the classical Miller capacitor and Miller effect and what is really happening here. And this is because we have a current source, and here also we have a load which is a current source. In the case of a load which is a resistive load, then of course you have sort of a voltage gain, and then in fact you can invoke the Miller effect. But if this is a current source, this is a current source, this is a constant current source, this is a dependent current source, then the current is coming through here, and therefore the impedance is independent on the value of the capacitor, but rather on GM, 1 over GM, and it is resistor, it's not capacitive. So this brings me to the end of this presentation. I hope you found it of interest, and perhaps it will be useful to you in the future. Thank you very much.